WWF, What the World is Watching.
Please let me explain.
We're on the air now. We promised these people a Christmas program with lights and trees and gifts. We've got N.O., not one wreath.
When I explain to you what happened, you won't feel this way.
I'm waiting.
Okay, last weekend in Philadelphia, I ran into a needy family. They had no tree, no lights, nothing. I had a tree set up here. I had all kinds of Christmas ornaments and balls. I had garland. I had lights. I had that wreath there. I had candles, I had everything festive. Little Santa Clauses, kind of you shake up and you see the snow. All that stuff. And this family explained to me they had no tree, they had nothing. So I had my people come in, take everything out. I overlooked that or we wouldn't have anything. And I gave it to the needy family in Philadelphia.
So they gave it to
a needy
family?
That's right, I gave it. It's Christmas time, what the heck?
I'm surprised.
You should be.
And a little bit shocked.
Why? I'm a human being.
If in fact
blood runs through my veins.
You, the Scrooge of the WWF? Give me a break. I'm going to check this out.
If in fact you did that,
there is another side to you.
You can see the faces on those little children when they saw that tree come over there.
Well,
I'll tell you, Mansu.
Maybe an apology is in order.
I'll tell you.
I will find out. I will get to the bottom of this. In the meantime, hello, everyone, and welcome to Primetime Wrestling. I realize that we're on the air here, but, you know, these sort of things happen. We've got an exciting Christmas program lined up for these folks.
I have brought gifts for the crew.
Oh, how lovely. How lovely. Interesting feature, Million Dollar Man taking on Coco Beware. But right now, we're going to take a look at Harley Race.
Introducing first to my one-year-old, all-time favorite returns to the ring. Weighing 235 pounds, Harley Race.
There he is, the former king.
His opponent from Tucson, Arizona, weighing 240 pounds, Jim Gorman.
Well, I'll tell you this, McMahon, it's remarkable after the injury Harley Race suffered at the hands of Hulk Hogan that the man so quickly is recouped enough to be back in that ring again.
It is remarkable. I'll agree with you there. And apparently, Harley Race would like very much again to regain his crown, his scepter, and his king. He wants to be king again. However, standing in his way, obviously, is the reigning king, King Haku, who had a few comments toward Mr. Race.
Race, you will be bowing at my feet just like everybody else, because I am the king.
Interesting matchup, huh?
Well, I'll tell you, I don't think Harley Race is going to take too kindly to that. I think a lot of people had written this man off. Figured he would never again step in that ring, but I'll tell you what, after watching him here, I don't think Harley Race has lost a thing.
Maybe not. The former king driving a knee into the throat area there of Mr. Gorman. Harley Race. Let me ask you a question. What do you think Bobby Heenan is going to do here? Is Heenan managing the king?
Of course Heenan's managing the king.
I didn't mean that. I meant, is Heenan managing Harley Race?
I would guess he's managing both of them.
So then, how does he account for the fact that Harley Race wants to be king again? I mean, that means the two of them would obviously clash together. Where does that leave Heenan?
I'll tell you where it leaves Heenan. Win or lose, Heenan wins either way, no matter which man wins, right? Hey, they don't call him the brain for nothing.
I guess not. Well, this will be most interesting to see just whom will be king. Harley Race now with that cradle suplex, the cover, and the three count. So Harley Race returning triumphantly here to the World Wrestling Federation.
Here is your winner, Harley Race.
Former king certainly hasn't lost anything inside that squared circle. It's going to be very interesting, Brain, come January 15th at the Summit in Houston. You're going to have to pick sides, aren't you?
Well, they're both family
You'll
members.
You'll wait for the winner, then picks, right?
Well, I'm telling you, let's say Harley defeats King Haku. There will be a whole coronation. We'll have the procession. We'll have the horns. We'll have the big
You'll
chair.
Just
they
shove
carry.
Haku aside
oh,
and
no,
open
oh, no.
arms for
I told him.
Harley Race.
See, when Harley went to the hospital, I never knew if he was going to return. There had to be a king. There had to be a king in the World Wrestling Federation. I went on a search. I found Haku. Everything just worked out this way.
Turned over a big rock, and there he was.
No, now Harley wants the crown back. He wants the robe back. He wants the title back. Haku doesn't want to give it back.
Why wouldn't he want it? You stole it from the guy. You sold the guy out.
No, I did. I was in that
just
hospital.
Just like you sold out Hercules down the river.
Him I did sell.
Yeah.
Nothing wrong with that, though. I was trying to find a position for him in life.
I got
but
news
Harley
for
Race,
you.
I was in that hospital every day when he was
there. You'd be lucky if Harley doesn't attack you.
No, I was in intensive care every
right
day
now,
when he was
there.
Right
now, let's take a look at where the WWF
I
is headed.
I never stole those
never
chocolates
sent
either.
A card.
It's the World Wrestling Federation All Tour coming to these great areas and facilities with action. Friday, December 30th, Dayton, Ohio, Hera Arena, the Ultimate Warrior will be in action in Dayton. Thursday, December 29th, Cedar Rapids, Iowa, Five Seasons Center. Hulk Hogan tops a great card in Cedar Rapids. Thursday, December 29th, Huntington, West Virginia, the Huntington Civic Center, the Honky Tonk Man among those of the card in Huntington. Thursday, December 29th, Utica, New York, Utica Memorial Auditorium. Jake the Snake Roberts seeing action in Utica. Wednesday, December 28th, Lincoln, Nebraska, Pershing Auditorium. $1 Million Man Ted DiBiase on the bill in Lincoln. Wednesday, December 28th, Bloomington, Minnesota, the Met Center. Hacksaw Jim Duggan among those on the card at the Met Center. It's the World Wrestling Federation. Be a part of it when it comes to your area.
Specialists, and indeed they are specialists, and they will need every bit of their ability, their tools of the trade, so to speak. And what are you whistling about?
Jingle bells. I'm in the mood. I can't help it.
You're in the mood. Who are all those boxes for?
They're for the crew here.
They're for the crew.
Yes, they are. I'm gonna.
Last year you gave them cash, $3. I remember.
Well, I had $1,000 I was going to give, but somebody picked my pocket.
Yeah, Brother Love did.
Brother Love didn't pick my
Wouldn't
pocket.
Wouldn't surprise me. Let's take a look at the Rockers. They take on Pete Sanchez and the Gladiator.
The following tag team contest is scheduled for one fall. Introducing first, weighing with a total combined weight of 468 pounds, here is Pete Sanchez. And his partner, the Gladiator. And their opponent, soon to be entering the ring,
here comes two of my favorite guys.
Tag
team specialist, huh, Monsoon?
Absolutely.
Oh, they're good. I'll admit that. They're fast. They're young. They're aggressive. They're hungry. They want the gold.
Shawn Michaels, Marty Jannetty.
They're not going to get by my brainbusters.
Two young superstars in the world of professional wrestling.
Well, thank you.
Talking about the Rockers.
You should be talking about the Brainbusters.
When I refer to the Brainbusters, it won't be as two young superstars in the World Wrestling Federation. They've been around quite some time, have they not?
Not really.
Oh, no. Who's the guy with the mask on, Brain?
That's the guy who's wrestling Shawn Michaels.
The Gladiator. But who really? Who's he really?
I don't know.
Not the Blue Blazer, I'll tell you that.
Cheap shot.
Very clever maneuver, I call it.
Had my men down there, you would have said a cheap shot.
Depends how you do it. You do it while you're looking at the guy, it's fair game. You do it when the guy's back's turned or he's distracted. Oh, look at this flying head scissors!
Very dangerous move. Had the Gladiator been alert, all you had to do was duck. Shawn Michaels would have been in the ninth row.
Pete Sanchez coming in unannounced. Paying the price. Double drop kick by the Rockers and another one.
What are they both doing in the ring?
Well, they're trying to make it even. See, the other two guys are in the ring. Are you watching the same thing I'm watching?
Yes, I'm watching the same thing you're watching.
Referee's got it back under control now. As best he can. Oh, Another capacity crowd on hand once again here this week on Wrestling Challenge for this World Wrestling Federation extravaganza. Look at the quickness on Jannetty. Where are you going now?
Yes? Be right there.
Will you stop? Why don't you just go out and stay out?
I have things to do.
I could get an orangutan to come in and sit in here. It would be more effective than you.
I'm sitting here with an orangutan.
He would walk out on me all the time.
Well, he's not too smart. I was summoned again. Mr. Rude is ready.
Oh, Mr. Rude is ready.
Ravishing
ready
on
for what?
To give some lucky lady the Rude Awakening and to give his opponent the Rude Awakening.
Will you stop?
I'm just about to do whatever he wants to do, so I'm going to be taking off in a little bit.
Goodbye.
Heading down the ring.
Why don't you leave now?
Because I'm trying to do my job as host of this program.
Oh. Well, why don't you get somebody else to take Ravishing to the ring then?
Oh, no.
How about Haku? Why don't you get Haku to take him down?
No, I don't want to go into that with you.
You don't?
I gotta go.
Oh.
I'll be back.
Have a nice trip. Don't bother.
Here we go.
Shawn Michaels perched up on the top of the shoulders of his partner. Forget it, right in the sternum. Knocked the wind out of Pete Sanchez. Here's Mike. Exciting once again here this week, and they can do it all. These guys are destined for stardom. Stay with us. Plenty more action still to come. Rockers and Brainbusters will indeed have a chance to get at each other, Brain, in the Royal Rumble.
Well, believe me, the Rockers don't want any part of the Brainbusters.
Are you kidding?
What happened in San Francisco, we went to the ring, and Arn Anderson reached in, and he tripped Shawn Michaels.
What do you call that?
Well, the bell had rung. It's called intimidation. It's no worse than a man walking out there with a snake. It's Christmas. I'm not going to get upset.
Why are you getting upset?
Then they dove over the ring, landed on the floor.
I have a gift for you, too, you know. It's not here yet.
Is it ticking?
No, it'll be here shortly. They had trouble getting it. They had trouble wrapping it.
You mean getting it in the bag, don't you?
I didn't say that.
It's a snake, isn't it?
I didn't say that.
I don't have any snakes.
It's a surprise.
I don't like your surprises. How did I have a trip to
Death Row? I don't like your hat.
It's not my hat. I've combed my hair this way.
Oh. Sorry.
Yes, it's my hat. I like my hat. It's Christmas. Talk about Scrooge. This guy's a Scrooge, not me. You and the Rockers can both be
talk
miserable Christmas.
Talk about rules. Here's a man who can tell
present
you what
guys.
The rules are all about, his lordship.
Hello, everyone. This week's special report takes a close look at a most unique event, the Royal Rumble. This takes place Sunday afternoon, January the 15th, from the Summit in Houston, and can also be seen on pay-per-view television. There will be 30 of the top World Wrestling Federation competitors vying to become the eventual winner. All the wrestlers will pick a number from 1 to 30. Two men will start, and every 2 minutes, another will enter the ring. From then on, it's every man for himself until only one remains. This will be the only time where you can see 30 of the World Wrestling Federation elite in the same match. Obviously, a lot depends upon the draw. Whoever draws an early number may be at a disadvantage. However, if that man is Hulk Hogan or, say, Andre the Giant, then surely they have the ability and determination to be in at the final bell. Perhaps it will take a wily, lighter man with speed and cunning, like the Red Rooster, to be there at the kill. Let us take a look at this impressive list of entrants. Macho Man Randy Savage, Big John Studd, The Million Dollar Man Ted DiBiase, Jake the Snake Roberts, The Brain Busters, Rick Martel, Andre the Giant, The Honky Tonk Man, Brutus the Barber Beefcake, The Mighty Hercules, Greg the Hammer Valentine, Tito Santana, Coco Beware, Demolition, Axe and Smash, The Red Rooster, Bad News Brown, The Rockers, Ron Bass, Akeem, Mr. Perfect, Rugged Ronnie Garvin, The Powers of Pain, Warlord and the Barbarian, and Hulk Hogan. All this takes place from the Summit, January the 15th. It's also on pay-per-view television. The special report, I'm Lord Alfred Hayes.
Yourself.
With my own two hands.
Oh, how nice.
It's Christmas.
Yeah, you're in the spirit, right?
It's a lot of people I don't like.
Uh-huh.
But at this time of the year at Christmas, I'm going to put all that aside. And I even got presents for the crew. And I have a special envelope coming for you.
You do?
Yes.
How exciting.
Just the thing that you're going to like.
I hope it's some of the money you owe me.
It's costing me something,
interesting matchup headed your way right now on this special prime time, the Red
the Rooster.
Entering the ring.
Thus far undefeated in single competition. I guess largely due to Mr. Heenan's efforts. Would you concur with that?
Well, if you ask Mr. Heenan, he'll definitely take credit for it.
Yeah. Rooster.
Terry Taylor.
His opponent from Dallas, Texas, at 242 pounds, Scott Casey.
This should be an outstanding matchup.
Definitely, the Rooster will get tested by the veteran Scott Casey because he's no pushover at all.
Indeed not. Advice there on the part of Bobby the Brain Heenan. I think the Rooster listens a little bit too much to Bobby Heenan. I think he gets a little too nervous when Bobby Heenan's around.
Now, how can you say that when he's unbeaten?
Well, just from his performance. We had an occasion to speak with the Rooster earlier. Here's what he had to say.
Bobby Heenan, you have taken the Red Rooster, and look what you've done. You said I didn't have it in the beginning, but through your guidance and through your directorship, I'm going to the top. Everything's going great. I am undefeated thanks to you, Bobby. And let me tell you right now, no matter what, I will not let you down. It's you and me forever.
Huh. At least the Rooster is somewhat appreciative of the efforts of his manager.
Certainly, he hasn't lost. I mean, the bottom line is the W in the column, McMahon. It ain't how you look getting the W. It's the win that counts.
Jesse, that sort of contradicts your career, doesn't it?
No, it doesn't at all.
You are a lot more concerned.
I not only looked good in the ring, I also won all the time. That was the main reason I retired, McMahon. No competition left.
I see. There, Bobby Heenan bringing the ring.
When he hooked the ropes and didn't go the second time, back off then. Slap him. But don't let him reverse it on you. When he's got your back in there, you hook the rope. Use your hand, you gotta think. Get in there now.
I love that. That reminds me, you know, like Barry Switzer in Oklahoma.
Yeah.
Same type of attitude.
Somewhat. Locking back up now, the veteran Scott Casey. To the rope, shoulder block, down goes the Rooster again. Off and back body drop, no! Nice maneuver there by the Rooster.
See, like Bobby said, use your brain in there. Now the Rooster's using it.
Rooster, as soon as he made that one spectacular maneuver there, looked right over at Bobby Heenan. I think Heenan is a distraction.
Finish him off.
Finish him off. Well, maybe the Rooster is going to be finished off.
Ooh, not a wow. Beautiful move. Clotheslined him right on the rope. Scott Casey is in trouble. And, you know, the Rooster's handling Casey much easier than I expected. He's got him in the cock of the walk.
He certainly does. Submission hold, and it's over. And so Bobby the Brain, along with the Red Rooster, remained victorious and undefeated in single competition. Oh, come on, ref, get in there. That's a very punishing hold.
Certainly, but Bobby wants to make sure it's been applied right. You know, with certain athletes, McMahon, you have to take that decisiveness that Heenan does right there.
Really?
Some athletes, you don't have to yell at them. Others, you do.
Some respond to negative criticism, some to positive, right?
Right. You know that if you were ever in sports in your life.
It works the same in chess. Here now the replay.
There you see Scott Casey firing the Red Rooster across the ring with a beautiful hip toss. The Rooster Heenan demanding him to come out to the floor. Gives him a little Barry Switzer verbal confrontation right there.
And then from there, finish him off,
yep.
Heenan says.
The Rooster gets in, hooks him in the cock of the walk, and gets a submission.
How far do you think you can go with that guy?
All the way to the top.
All the way to the top.
See, he's limited, but if he just listens and doesn't try to think for himself, if he lets me bring him along, teach him how to think, teach him how to move, counter moves.
Why should he be any different than all the others that have been in your
family?
There's
just something about him struck me. He's aggressive. He's just like a...
Does he like snakes? Maybe he likes snakes.
This man's freaked out on snakes.
You and Andre are.
All you
want to
talk about is snakes.
You want to talk about snakes? Where are
you going? How's Christmas?
I had a cramp in my leg. I was trying to move my foot over a little bit.
Let me see over there.
There's nothing there. I told you that I had trouble getting it into... I mean, wrapping it up.
Getting it in the bag.
No, I didn't say that.
Get out of here.
What do you mean, get out of here?
Get out of here.
Well, I'm not going. Well, we are going somewhere right now. We're going to go to Sean Mooney and
you
the
may
World
not
Wrestling
get a gift.
Federation Start Event Center.
Stuff.
What's wrong? You got a gift for Sean Mooney?
No, I'm going to let him go to the airport
Let's
and sell the books
the
like
event
you used
center,
to.
Please.
We are back at the World Wrestling Federation Event Center, the Royal Rumble. It happens in Houston at the Summit January 15th. The action will kick off at 4 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, and you can see it live in Houston or on a pay-per-view basis. 30 superstars of the World Wrestling Federation involved in the Royal Rumble. And right now, let's hear from two of the participants, Andre the Giant and Hulk Hogan.
I want all you tough guys to listen to this. Every 2 minutes, another wrestler enters that ring. It starts with two, and it ends with one. So every 2 minutes, somebody's going to be coming down that aisle. And Hogan, Savage, and especially you, Robert, I hope you're all in the ring when this man comes through that
Because
ring.
I will be the last one in the ring. I will be the last one in there. I don't scare anybody. Anybody can come in the ring any time they want. I don't care. I will win that Rumble Royal.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. ZZ Top Fandango. Houston, Texas, Hulkamaniacs. We're going to have a Royal Rumble. And what are you going to do when Hulkamania and the largest arms in the world rumble on you, top contenders? You know there's going to be 30 dudes in that ring, man. Numbers 1 to 30. You could come in and fight all night long if you get number 1. Or you could be lucky and get number 30 and be fresh as a daisy. But to the Hulkster and all my Hulkamaniacs, it doesn't matter what number we get. As far as we're concerned, there are no friends on that night. Everybody in there's an enemy. Oh, yeah, I got my favorites. The Big Boss Man, Akeem. I'm going after them first so I can beat on them all night long. But you know something? If we win this thing, which we will, that'll put us right back in that number one contender spot. And you know what that means, don't you? What you gonna do when the largest arms in the world rumble on you?
Hulk Hogan and Andre the Giant set for battle in the Royal Rumble. It will happen January 15th, that is Sunday afternoon, at the Summit in Houston. And here's how you can see it.
See the Royal Rumble Sunday afternoon, January 15th, from the Summit in Houston, Texas. Call your local cable system for pay-per-view availability.
An action-packed afternoon from the Summit in Houston, January 15th. It all starts at 4 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. See it on pay-per-view.
January 15th, the World Wrestling Federation presents the Royal Rumble. 30 superstars battle it out. See it live from the Summit in Houston, Texas, 4 p.m. Eastern, exclusively on pay-per-view. Order now.
The big countdown to the Royal Rumble has begun. It is January 15th, an afternoon affair at the Summit in Houston. You're going to be there, right?
Oh, yes, I'm going to be there.
You're involved in so many things. How could you not be there?
I'm going to be there. I told you I was going to be
there.
You
got five guys that I can account for right here.
That's right.
That are involved in this Royal Rumble. Well, I'm giving you DiBiase. He's actually not one of your guys, but I figured that
associates.
He's got you in his pocket.
No, he doesn't have me in his pocket, but whatever he wants, he can have from me.
He can have.
You know, at Christmas time, you won't offend me with cash.
Let's take a look now, Mr. Perfect.
This next bout is scheduled for one fall. Soon to be making his way to the ring area from Elk River, Minnesota, weighing 249 pounds, Mr. Perfect, Kurt Hennig.
Well, they say if you can do it, it ain't bragging. And he does a lot of talking, but he's been able to back up his words with action.
And his opponent, from Morristown, Tennessee, weighing 228 pounds, Tim Horner.
They're going to boo him because he's from the South. We're in the Boston Gardens. I don't care. I know they don't like Kurt Hennig, but here's the guy from Tennessee in the Boston Gardens. That doesn't match up too well with the locals.
Everything that Kurt Hennig has done so far has been perfect. And he carries the name Mr. Perfect, justifiably so. No one has been able to hardly touch him, say anything about stop him so far. And whatever he has done and or tried outside of the ring has been perfect as well.
Lord Alfred Hayes, this is my first glimpse of this guy, Horner, from Tennessee. You got any background? You got any scoops on this guy? What's his...
About 4 years ago, I saw him as a youngster when he first started a campaign in the ring.
and he was wrestling from Charlotte at that particular time, where a number of very good wrestlers have come from. So he's had a good background, a good knowledge of wrestling was bred into him from the beginning, but he's against a fantastic wrestler here, and Mr. Perfect is going to make a lesson and an example out of Tim Horner.
Horner, only 228 pounds, I say, only, and hey, that's good size for a man, but he's going up against the guy who is in there at about 255. Wow, he uses a very sharp elbow that gets Mr. Perfect's attention in a hurry.
Well, Mr. Perfect yelled over at us that he's a technician, and he wants to be known as Mr. Perfect the Technician, so let's see what he can do, man. We know he can...
Mr. Horner is somewhat of a technician himself.
Yes.
Three nice moves by Tim Horner, capping it off with a drop kick that sends Mr. Perfect hurtling out of the ring.
And Lord Alfred Hayes, your background assessment was great.
Let's have a look and see what Horner did, if he did any damage, real damage to Perfect. Here he comes with a beautifully timed body slam, and he twists it. Now look at this drop kick. It was a good drop kick, but it didn't hit Perfect in the face. You know, sometimes Mr. Perfect tests the firepower of his adversaries, and he may have been doing that right just then. Look, he's got back into the ring very, very confident.
Very good point, Lord Alfred Hayes. It did not catch Mr. Perfect in the face. It caught him in the shoulders, across the pectoral muscles. There was a lot of momentum on it, but he's back in, and he is moving and moving quick back and forth. Hey, look at that, a nice arm drag by Horner. They were going 50, 60 miles, a bit perplexed, Mr. Perfect.
Perfect better slow down, Lord and Rod, in my opinion, right now. And, you know, he maybe ought to take another walk outside and go ahead and slow down and reconsider his opponent and his opponent's ability.
Did you hear the question that
when
he
you,
asked?
When you move that fast, you're inclined to make a few errors.
You get out of control. There's no two ways about it. And Mr. Perfect asking, where did you get this guy from? Well, Mr.
Tennessee.
Perfect, he's from Morristown, Tennessee. Big scare down here by Mr. Perfect. Mr. Perfect, that's not really going to bother Tim Horner, I do not believe. You're going to have to wrestle the man. You can't outstare him and beat him that way. And Mr. Perfect can indeed do that. I'm talking about wrestling. He knows all of the moves.
Oh, that was a nice move.
Indeed, a very nice reversal here by Horner. Hey, Horner is showing and showing very well.
Horner can wrestle. Hey, that might be just what it takes, Lord and Rod, to upset the perfect record of Mr. Perfect. Some extremely nice wrestling moves that this kid has shown us right now.
Some perfect wrestling moves, in fact, huh?
No question about it. With a lot of speed, too.
Mr. Perfect in pain.
Well, I heard earlier in the evening, Mr. Perfect said he's going to take this kid out in about a minute and a half. That was a word I got in the locker room in my area back there. A minute and a half, he'd be down and over with. But it's been about 7 minutes into the match already, and the kid's shining from Tennessee.
Indeed, Horowitz. Horner acquitting himself very, very well.
But he better take advantage of all he can get out of Kurt Hennig right now, because Kurt, as we just seen right there, man, is sly like a fox.
Horowitz is extremely quick. As
Tim Horner is wrestling extremely confidently here. He's making some nice moves.
Yes.
You know what he's doing? He's allowing Mr. Perfect to make mistakes.
Yes, he is. But what's going to happen now, Lord and Rod, I guarantee you, Mr. Perfect is going to open up. Forget about the wrestling moves and the pretty stuff. He's going to open up with some real rough stuff. There was a pretty move right there. But it's going to take more than that to beat this guy from Tennessee. And I guarantee you, Mr. Perfect is going to open up on him anytime now.
Well, he's got to do that because this kid has out-wrestled him so far.
Correct. He's getting nowhere. And there's your first opening up move right there. A knee to the stomach.
Twice to the solar plexus and then twice to the back of the head.
On the top that was.
Indeed. All by Mr. Perfect on Tim Horner. And Horner reverses here. Nice arm drag by Horner.
Horner's still in the game. I'm surprised. I thought when Kurt Hennig opened up on him right there, Mr. Perfect opened up, that would be it. It'd be lights out for the guy Horner, but what a reversal that was, man. He's hanging in tough.
What a nice change Horner affected just then on Mr. Perfect. He had him by the left arm, and he switched his hold completely. Very, very baffling move. But look what Perfect does. When he hurts you, he really hurts you.
It'd be the beginning of the end right now for Horner.
After a period of time, those blows take a greater effect. There is a snap suplex by Mr. Perfect.
That'll teach you, boy.
As he shouts to his opponent, Tim Horner, that'll teach you, boy. And, hey, Horner fires right back. But he gets two more blasts across the back of the head.
Oh, he's going in for the kill. A lot of humiliation before the kill coming up for Horner. You can see in the eyes of Mr. Perfect. He's got the killer look on him right now. He's going in for the, making the moves, going in for the kill.
Yes, now he wants to humiliate Horner because in the beginning, Horner definitely humiliated him.
Yes, outsmarted him, outmoved him. And now Curt Hennig, Mr. Perfect, is going in for the kill, man. You can see in his eyes.
Horner is certainly doing more than just showing up here. He is giving Mr. Perfect, Curt Hennig, all he wants and then some, at least so far. Hard body slam by Mr. Perfect. And across the frontal lobes he goes.
Stopping him up right now, going in, making some real tough moves on him.
Here's a snap there, and that can snap your neck. That move by Curt Hennig, that's of course the exact object of it.
This is shades of the camel clutch on Lord Alfred Hayes, is that correct?
Yes, absolutely. He doesn't have those arms trapped, but he's got it nicely balanced there. He's sitting low on the back of Tim Horner. But this kid's game. He's very, very game.
Indeed. Very game and very durable.
Well, he wants to make the big time, man. He's in the World Wrestling Federation, you understand? And he wants to make a good impression.
Nice drop kick there.
Perfect.
He would call it, I guess, the perfect drop.
I would call that perfect,
yes,
too.
And you've got to give credit where credit's due. That was an excellent drop kick, Rod. I mean, there's no question about it. The guy's an egomaniac, but that was right on the button. Standing drop kick, not just get about three rows out in the, maybe the fifth row of the rails right there.
Hennig resumes his attack. Mr. Perfect on the attack, a couple of right hands. Horner paying the price now. Against the young man from Elk River, Minnesota, suburb of the Twin Cities of Minneapolis and St. Paul. Second generation wrestler, his father, Larry the Axe Hennig, and we all remember him.
Horner trying to get back in the ring, lost his balance right there. From fatigue, that's why he put off the ring, Lord and Rod. The kid's been beaten up pretty good here. And he's getting softened up by Hennig.
You know what I like about Curt Hennig, too? That every time he has a complete awareness of where he is in the ring. He positions himself perfectly for every move he makes. He knows where he is.
However, Horner caught him by surprise there with a shoulder block and then two right hands and another one that just about sends Mr. Perfect to the canvas. There's three more. Mr. Perfect staggering back, pushed into the corner, whipped across to the other one, and now an elbow
straight elbow
by Tim Horner. A big, big elbow. Mr. Perfect in a bit of trouble here.
Horner should go for a pinfall right now.
Nice drop kick there.
Roll him up, small package, anything, man. He's got him rocking and rolling right here.
There it is, the small package, but he gets only a one count. Mr. Perfect certainly has to wonder what's going on. He takes an atomic drop there. Tim Horner in a clothesline. This may be over.
He should have hooked him with more authority, Lord Alfred Hayes and Rod Bungard. He should have really hooked him tight.
He's just a kid, but he can certainly wrestle. There's no doubt about that.
Oh!
Big mistake.
Mr. Perfect saw it coming.
His first high-risk move that he's made, and he missed with it. That's inexperience.
I guarantee you that's the beginning of the end for this kid, that move right there.
All right, front face lock. Over he goes. Look at that bridge. One, two, three.
Mr. Perfect will indeed get a chance to really prove himself as January 15th is rapidly approaching, and he is.
Jaime?
One of the big guns here.
Star four, man.
Royal Rumble.
For you, Jaime. Merry
Here's
Christmas.
Some of the participants. Big John Studd, Hulk Hogan, Randy Savage, Jake the Snake, Rick Martel returning. How do you like that?
Wow, that's exciting. I think I'll just go
you
out
bet
maybe,
you. Brutus the Barber Beefcake, Hercules, Tito Santana, Coco Beware, Demolition, The Bushwhackers.
The Bushwhackers, yeah, they should be institutionalized.
The Red Rooster, the Rockers, Ronnie Garvin, the Brainbusters, Andre, DiBiase, the Honky Tonk Man, the Hammer Valentine, Bad News Brown, Outlaw Ron Bass, Akeem Mr. Perfect, Powers of Pain, and the guy with the club and the handcuffs, the Big Boss Man.
And it's every man for himself.
That's right. You're not going to like some of the things that are going to go on.
Probably
won't.
In fact,
you folks out there are not going to like some of the things you're going to see in the Royal Rumble. Because you're going to see guys attacking guys who you never dreamed would happen. We'll be right back.
This week is a man, they tell me, a very big man. Why, a giant of a man.
Gene Force has returned to the World Wrestling Federation. I'm not referring to Brother Love, that white suit piece of garbage.
It's Christmas time. How can those words come out of your mouth?
It's very easy. He's a piece of garbage. Whether it's Christmas, Halloween, New Year's, or what, Thanksgiving, whatever. When a guy's a piece of junk, a guy's a piece of junk.
Give this to Abe on the camera over there.
Abe? We don't have an Abe.
Yes.
We do?
I have a present for everybody, all cameramen, the makeup girl, and the lighting guy. Got everything. Don't
you
worry.
You got a present for the lighting guy?
No.
No, he don't get one.
You get to change a job.
Let's take a look at Big John Studd. Forget about the guy standing next to him.
I love you.
He's genuine, isn't he?
They tell me he is strong, that he stands 6'10".
It's not on me.
And weighs in excess of 385 pounds. And they call him Big John.
Whoa. He is big.
You certainly are a big, big boy. They tell me that when you were here in the World Wrestling Federation, that you were probably one of the toughest men ever to set foot in a wrestling ring.
That's right.
They tell me that you were probably one of the strongest men ever to set foot in a wrestling ring.
That's right.
Why, they tell me that you were the top dog at one time. And, you know, I know that is true, and I know why it is true. Because of your manager, Brother Brain, Bobby Heenan. And I have a special surprise for you, here to welcome you with open arms, your manager,
reunited. Whoa, Stud literally turning his back on Heenan.
Yeah, put it there. What? Why won't you shake Brother Brain's hand and welcome him with the accolade he deserves?
Because Heenan is a weasel.
Whoa.
John, you don't understand.
Why would Stud turn on Heenan?
John, we're friends. What about the family?
Whoa.
Family. What about the family?
I am no longer part of the Heenan family. Do you understand?
I think we're talking about rejection here.
What about the Royal Rumble and being a part of the family in the Royal Rumble?
I'll be at the Royal Rumble, and if anybody from the Heenan family steps in my way, I'll mow them down one by one.
Well, you may be a very big man, but you are only
Big John Studd.
I don't understand this, McMahon.
Big John Studd, one of the on favorites, Brain, along with Andre the Giant, of course, to be victorious in the Royal Rumble.
When you're that big, you have to be. You have to be smart in there, too.
But,
you know, talking about the lighting man, you know, to work the lights, you have to be bright. And I don't know how he got the job.
You didn't get anything for him. Some of the lights are going out.
What's happening here? No, I didn't mean the lighting man here.
Oh.
No, I meant the one in Cincinnati. Matter of fact, Jaime. Get a little envelope. Give this to the lighting guy. Tell him Merry Christmas from the Brain.
You remember the envelope I gave you last year you refused to take?
Yeah, it had $1,000 in it.
$1,000 bill, yes.
Okay, I'll take it this year.
No, I'm sorry. I have something else this year for you.
Is it an envelope?
No, it's in a bag. A green bag. But it's got a ribbon on it, and it's really nice. You're going to enjoy it.
Oh, I love snakes with ribbons on it. You bring that snake out here, you're here by yourself.
You know, you don't have to take it. You can give it to Andre. Do whatever you want. We're going to be back.
Fans, this bout is scheduled for one fall. Introducing first, from the Soviet Union, weighing 287 pounds, Boris Zhukov.
Boris Zhukov, of course, of the Bolsheviks.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Zhukov wishes you to please rise for his singing of the Soviet national anthem.
What a response, huh? That's one of the things you gotta withstand when the Russians are in town. You gotta put up with the singing of the national anthem from Russia. That might be his best move tonight.
I have to believe that.
And his opponent this evening making his way down the aisle.
Definitely a better
from Downers Grove, Illinois. At 240 pounds,
anyway.
Leaping Lenny Popoff.
Oh, Mr. Excitement here. Leaping Lenny Popoff.
Lenny Popoff is minus a few frisbees,
Ladies and gentlemen, now a poem for Mr. Popoff.
I think he's got something to say.
That great big ugly Russian thinks he's worth $1 million. He had better stick to wrestling because his singing really sucks.
Oh, really?
Very good. Leaping
Chapter,
Lenny.
Yes.
Yeah, the poet. But every time he cranks out one of those poems, he gets attacked.
And apparently Boris did not like the poem at all as he went at it before the bell ever sounded. And now it is Leaping Lenny popping away. And look at that as he grabs a hold of the hair growth on the chin of Boris Zhukov.
All right, Lenny's on fire tonight, Rod. The man has been in the gym. I'd say he's 15 pounds heavier than the last time I saw him, maybe 3 or 4 weeks ago. And Zhukov on the floor is wondering where his partner's at. Nikolai Volkov, used as a tag team. No one to tag out to tonight, Rod.
That's right. The tag team combination, of course, that we refer to, the Bolsheviks, Boris Zhukov and Nikolai Volkov.
And you know, a little earlier when the match started with that poem, usually Leaping Lenny throws out those frisbees, you know, to the souvenirs
right.
for the kids. But he told me earlier on there were 3 or 4 Special Olympic children here in the audience, and on the way he was going to give them out personally to the Special Olympic children. So that's where the frisbee went. And I think that's a nice gesture on Lanny's part.
Absolutely. Zhukov back in.
And right now, Popoff should have nailed Zhukov. If anybody in the World Wrestling Federation turns your back on him, forget the backflips, brother. Go ahead and attack him. Go ahead and hit him. Forget the pointing and forget the backflips. You turn your back on someone, you deserve to get nailed. I guarantee you one thing, Ron. If I was in there, I'd hit him.
Side headlock here for Boris Zhukov. You hear the chant. Zhukov grabbing a hold of the hair as Popo tried to break that side headlock. One more time, yes.
Asking the Russian if he grabbed and pulled the hair is like asking a piece of granite. Same answer.
There are a lot of people who say that that's what's on the shoulders of Boris Zhukov. Look at that backflip.
A little help from my friend, the referee, Rod.
Red Shoes Duggan. Hey, turnabout is fair play.
Oh, yeah, he definitely returned the favor. No hair on the head, so he goes for the beard. Why not?
Absolutely. But now it is Zukov grabbing a hold of Popo's hair, and Lanny grabs a hold of the whiskers again.
And Popo's going to have to do more grabbing than just whiskers to win this match, Rod Trongard. He's going to have to get down and hurt the big Russian. He's going to have to be aggressive and have a little bit of a killer instinct, because you can only play with Boris Zukov so long before he turns vicious and turns nasty. He's taking a walk again. He's taking his time, because Popo's definitely got the little bit of aggression going here, but he's got to do some real damage to the man. Pulling on his beard is not going to cause him to submit. Might make him madder even. Because you know what's going to happen sooner or later. Zukov is going to nail Leaping Lanny Popo as he comes in for another beard pull or some amateur act like that. He needs to get serious and get down and grab a hold.
And now Zukov apparently wants a show of strength here.
I think Popo can match strength. Look at the pecs on Popo from this angle.
Yes,
the guy,
indeed.
He's in the gym. He's
yes,
been.
Indeed.
He's told me he's on a strict regimen, pumping iron every day, a great diet, and I believe he should give the Russian a chance. Go ahead and take it. I think Popo's got a good shot.
Hey. I thought he was going to come out right in our lap there for a second. Boris Zukov is who we are speaking of, and again, the challenge is out to Lanny Popo, and he is going to accept it.
Popo's down on the knees, Rob, but don't count him out. He, as I mentioned, he's definitely been in the gym. I see some size and bulk. Instead of going for power, he went for finesse right there.
Nice move by Popo. And now he has Zukov on the defensive.
And that puts some pressure on the wrist. I guarantee you right there. That reversal that he just made getting out of that hold puts some real pressure, and Zukov is... Why complain to the referee, man? He can do you no good.
Burning the wax in the referee's ear there for a while. Side headlock here, Zukov. Oh, hard shoulder. And Popo felt that one. Nice drop toe hold.
I tell you what, I really think Lanny Popo can take this match. The way it appears to me, he's got Zukov confused. He's got him a little bit frustrated. And if Popo really gets down, he's got a tremendous hold right here. He could probably snap that ankle if he put enough pressure on it.
There's a lot of pressure on the knee as well.
Oh, yes, that's right. The knee joint, the tibia of the bone connects the ankle to the knee and the ankle itself. If he cranks down, we might get a submission right here.
You get a good look at it right there. And you get a good look at Zukov for a second, grabbing hold of the hair of Lanny Popo.
If Popo could get up and keep the hold and drop some knees, his own knee into Zukov's bicep femoris on the back of his leg there, it really caused some stress, and he might get a submission. But he's got to do some more damage other than just holding onto the hold itself, Rod.
Hey, a little biting there by Popo.
I'm surprised Zukov doesn't make a move for the ropes. He's only about 2 feet from the ropes. I'm surprised he's not crawling like a reptile, snake that he is, and make a move for the rope, Rod.
He just might be very shortly. And again, Popo bites away on the fingers of Boris Zukov here at the Los Angeles Sports Arena. Hello again, everyone. Rod Trongard along with superstar Billy Graham and the call of the action.
We're seeing some power out of Zukov right there. Reached up with the left arm, Rod, and powered out of it. Oh, Popo turned into a hammerlock and a chicken wing. What a reversal that was. So far, Rod has been all Popo.
Absolutely. Absolutely. There's been more talk from Zukov than just about anything else.
Yeah, walking and talking on the floor to the referee.
But exactly how much damage Popo has done so far in this, I really don't know, other than it looks like he has damaged the right knee of Zukov here in the last moment or two, and Zukov is going to buy some time.
Yeah.
Now he's favoring the left knee.
Favoring it, yeah. That was the one that was being worked on, but Popo should go in and make the attack. It was perfect, just as he's doing now, Rod. The man tries to buy time and begs you off. Attack him. Don't back up.
Pounding away.
There's a smart wrestler right there, Rod Trongard, a smart wrestler. Stay on him. Let the referee go ahead and back yet, but go back and attack. Always attack. Go forward in the World Wrestling Federation. Never back off.
Popo, what does he have in mind for Zukov? Well, you see what he had in mind. And now the step over toe hold. And more pressure again on that left leg of Boris Zukov. Referee checking the shoulders very, very closely. Oh! Twice with a hard right hand by Zukov, and three times. And Popo's, Zukov looks like he has really damaged that left knee.
Yeah, Popo's damaged the forearm, Rod, and Popo's right back to the attack. Smart, smart wrestler, man. Stay on the injured area. Stay on the area that's been hurt. Don't get off of it.
You're in there to win.
Oh!
And indeed, he is doing that very thing.
I tell you what, I'm impressed with this kid, Popo, right now. I've never seen him this aggressive and this full of spunk and vinegar. He wants to win, Rod.
Like you said a little earlier, he's put on about 10 or 15 pounds, and he has been doing a lot of work in the gymnasium.
So far, it's been all Popo. Two-thirds of this match has been all Popo. Two-thirds of it.
Uh-oh. Zukov caught him in the eye. Thus, the hold is broken. Zukov, now, is he able to follow up? He's limping around, as you can see.
He's limping, and Popo's blinded.
And now Zukov going to biting on Lanny Popo. Now upstairs, downstairs, upstairs and down. And Zukov.
Oh, he's popping him hard.
Is really chopping away on Lanny Popo.
But he's still got a hurt knee, Rod.
Indeed he does. Here's a cover.
Way too soon for a pin on Popo. He's hurt, but he's not hurt bad enough to take a match. But that might have did the job right there.
That cement floor underneath that cushion covering.
That's right. And I think Zukov threw Popo out not only to hurt him, but to give him some time to recover. Talking
exactly.
About, yeah, give Zukov himself time to recover. Oh, what a
tremendous
shot that was.
Smash. Here by Zukov across the pectoral muscles of leaping Lanny Popo.
That echoed through the sports arena, Rod.
Indeed, it did.
And we got to be careful because Zukov is known for a foreign object, carries him at all times. The referees, very, very few times did they ever find that object.
Drills Popo again, and here is that largest of all heads in the world of professional wrestling, and hardest, as I have been told. And an elbow chop here by Boris Zukov, but it is Popo again grabbing a hold.
Here comes
of the left
now.
Leg. Look out. This can rip and tear cartilage and ligaments.
Could be the beginning of the end right now for Zukov.
And he gives it to him again.
Popo should pull him right back inside and grab a step over toe hold, man. I guarantee he'll get a submission. This is the way I'd like to see Popo work right here, working hard, being aggressive, staying on top of his man, giving no quarters and taking no quarters right there.
And he indeed is doing that. However, he backs off after the referee forced him to break the hold. Now he is again back on the attack of Boris Zukov with a hard right. And here,
Zukov is ready for the pickings, Rod.
Yes, he is. And there is a hard right hand, and here is a big monkey flip. He didn't get quite as much as he wanted. Popo, I'm talking about a back heel kick to the sternum. Now he goes back to work here again. No, he wanted the monkey flip. Instead, it's a pile driver or the atomic drop. An atomic drop, however, Zukov pays the price with that left knee again.
I don't see how that knee can support the body weight of Zukov. I don't understand it. He's taking a tremendous amount of abuse and a lot of trauma to the knee. As we can see right there, Zukov limping off in the back, trying to jump off the second strand.
Popo doesn't know where he's at. Oh, caught him with a flying clothesline. Hooks the leg and has him.
I'm surprised, Rod. Surprised at that one.
I am too, to be perfectly honest with you, as the referee raises the hand of Boris Zukov. Let's get the official announcement.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of the bout, Boris Zukov.
One half of the Bolsheviks, Boris Zukov, putting away Lonnie Poffo, and we see how it happened
right here.
Yes, right
here, Zukov coming up the top rope, second rope, rather, with a flying clothesline, catches Poffo flush on the jaw, right on the chin, and let's say it's an easy pin because I think it knocks him out cold, 1, 2, 3, but prior to this, it was all Lonnie Poffo, and I believe Poffo should have got the match.
Million Dollar Man is our feature this week.
That's correct.
Did I explain that earlier on? Did I say that he and Coco, along with Frankie, and we got a nice gift from Coco, incidentally.
Would you have to have your shoe shine?
No. It was none of your business what the gift
was. None of my business.
Heim.
Can you pass the rest of these up? This is for Sophie, the makeup girl. This is for Abe. This is for Stanley. Merry Christmas.
I don't believe I'm seeing this.
What?
I don't. This is a side of you that I don't know, Brian.
A lot of sides you haven't seen of me yet.
There isn't little notes in those packages or anything. Bills or IOUs.
No, are you kidding me?
No.
Insult somebody like that at this festive Yuletide.
You would do it, yes. You and Brother Love would do it. I could see both of you. You in red and him in white.
You know, he went to the orphanage the other day.
He picked up whatever he could, right? Stole toys from those kids. I believe that. Plenty more excitement still to come, but right now let's go to Sean Mooney and the World Wrestling Federation Event Center.
And we are back at the Event Center, the Royal Rumble, coming to you from Houston at the Summit. It takes place Sunday afternoon, January 15th, with a 4 p.m. Eastern Standard Time start. You can see it live in Houston or on a pay-per-view basis. Remember, in the Royal Rumble, a man is eliminated once he is thrown over the top rope and onto the floor. The last man in the ring will win the Royal Rumble. 30 superstars of the World Wrestling Federation will be involved. And right now, standing by are the Million Dollar Man Ted DiBiase and the Macho Man Randy Savage.
A Royal Rumble. What a Royal Rumble says to me is that there are no rules and that anything goes. You win any way you can. And in the business world, I didn't become a multimillionaire by being a nice guy. You only get to the top by being as cutthroat as possible, and I'm at the top of that list. And in this Royal Rumble, I'll be at the top of the list, too. The Royal Rumble, yeah. People in the Royal Rumble gotta realize that it's every man for himself. You understand what that means, Elizabeth? No tag team partners, yeah. And still, in the echoes of my mind, I realize that you, Andre the Giant, is a big factor in the Royal Rumble, yeah. And then Bad News Brown, things that you have said, even though the mass hysteria, with all those bodies in the ring, if I see you, yeah, one time to the face, yeah, downtown, and still win the Royal Rumble. Old man Randy Savage has got to be the favorite. Yeah, because I'm the World Wrestling Federation champion. And I figure, yeah, that nobody can stop me. No, not Bad News Brown, not Akeem, not the Big Boss Man, not even Houston, Texas. Yeah, the champion is talking to you. And Houston, the Macho Madness is coming. Yeah.
The World Wrestling Federation champion, the Macho Man, Randy Savage, he plans to be the last man in the ring in the Royal Rumble, Sunday afternoon, January 15th, and here's how you could be a part of it all.
See the Royal Rumble, Sunday afternoon, January 15th, from the Summit in Houston, Texas. Call your local cable system for pay-per-view availability.
The Royal Rumble and so much more coming to you from Houston at the Summit Sunday afternoon, January 15th, a 4 p.m. Eastern Standard Time start, and you can be a part of it. Nintendo Entertainment System presents Bret Hitman Hart, Jim the Anvil Neidhart, the Hart Foundation. Here, the Anvil fair hugs his helpless opponent, and off the ropes, the Hitman connects with a powerful clothesline. The Hart Foundation, together, the beat.
The World Wrestling Federation presents the Royal Rumble. 30 superstars battle it out. See it live from the Summit in Houston, Texas, 4 p.m. Eastern, exclusively on pay-per-view. Order now.
Sure, absolutely.
He got a phone call, so I guess the next match we're going to be going.
Are you sure? Did you see him do that? Well, I apologize.
Isn't this rude?
I would take care of that, Frank, honest.
This is very rude. We're having a television show.
Get some toys, get a tree, a big turkey.
He's having somebody do his shopping for him. This guy's really into Christmas movies.
Yes, and be sure that family
gets all
that.
You know, I think everybody...
And just next time I see you, just give me the bill, whatever.
I think everybody at Christmas time should get together with their family and maybe sit around
and
have a nice hot
cup of... apologize for us, please.
Cinnamon and
thank you very much,
apple
and
juice.
Thanks for calling.
Sing some carols. Our next match.
You piece of garbage. You did it again.
What?
What? What'd you do with the money?
Oh, you haven't got any money.
You haven't got any money?
No.
You know who that was on the phone? Frank Rizzo, former mayor of Philadelphia.
And police chief?
Yes.
What'd you do now?
One of his men saw you in the parking lot at the Spectrum selling some of our Christmas things to a needy family.
No, no,
selling
no.
Money changing
no,
hands.
No, no, please. You got to believe me on this one. I know what you're talking about. Don't wrap me up. I know what you're talking about.
After I'll never believe you again as long as I live.
After I loaded the tree and the gifts in their car, I handed them $50 out of my own pocket. That's the cash he saw. They refused it and shoved it back. I wouldn't take money from a needy family like that. Monsoon, I'm talking to you.
Here on Saturday night's main event, and obviously, Jesse, you can tell the Warrior is pumped as always.
Oh, definitely. Like I call him, the ultimate maniac, McMahon. You know, this dude is not playing with a full deck of cards.
Well, a little strange, a little unusual side, no doubt of that. What do you know about the ninja, however?
I only know what Mr. Fuji has told me.
Wait a minute, Jesse. You're supposed to know everything about everything in the world of the World Wrestling Federation.
Well, I certainly know more than you, McMahon. So all I could say is what Mr. Fuji has told me. He said the guy is a deadly weapon.
A deadly weapon?
A deadly weapon from the Orient that he's found.
Lead a chop right away! The Super Ninja Chop has no effect on the Warrior. Has no effect. How deadly is he going to... Oh, with a kick, but no, he misses. The Warrior making him look like a fool!
A Warrior! All I could say, McMahon, maybe Fuji lied to me.
I don't think that would be the case.
Give the match a little bit more here. Let's see.
Another kick and a horrible... Oh, my goodness! Right on his head! A Warrior making mincemeat thus far out of the Super Ninja, who's anything but super thus far. Missing with the clothesline right back, and there's a Warrior with a kick.
A ninja out onto the floor.
And from the looks of things, Mr. Fuji, a little upset, to the outside, the Ultimate Warrior. Well, he'll take the battle to the outside, the inside, it doesn't matter with this man.
Now, what is the purpose of this?
He wants to get him back into the ring so he can go to work on it.
But that's a wrestler's prerogative if he's outside the ring to get a chance to recoup himself instead of this maniac throwing him back in.
Not if you're wrestling with the Ultimate Warrior. It's not a prerogative.
Obviously.
To the buckle. The Warrior in control of the moment. His very first appearance on Saturday night main event. And again, the Warrior really put together. When you compare Jesse to Bobby's physique, years ago even, to the Ultimate Warrior, is just like comparing horse manure to ice cream.
Or kind of like me comparing my body to yours right now, right?
We may have a pose down one of these days. The Warrior right now is really going to work on the Super Ninja.
And the Super Ninja, like you said, has been anything but super so far.
Ooh, there's a clothesline for you. Look out! The Ninja may be going for a ride. This capacity crowd on here. Look at Mr. Fuji's face a moment ago. A look of concern, and justifiably so. Look out! Up goes the Ninja!
9-10 feet in the air right there, McMahon.
Only one place to go. Gravity brings him down. The Warrior to the far side, and up and down. The Ninja rolled over. Cover and penetrate.
You know, McMahon, it's a good thing this guy wore a mask.
It sure is, Jesse.
Because I certainly wouldn't want anyone seeing me take a beating like that.
You referred to him as a deadly weapon. Now he's only deadly.
Hey, all I can do is tell you what Fuji told me, and apparently Fuji gave me a bum steer.
The Ultimate Warrior!
Frank Rizzo's got it in for me. Rizzo never liked me. He's just trying to make up stories. I told you I had him.
Do you think that one of those officers would lie to the former mayor of Philadelphia?
You mean Philadelphia's finest? Probably.
You,
I don't
they
know
said
them.
You and a guy that they didn't recognize in a white suit were stuffing things into the trunk of this car and in the meantime stuffing money into your pocket.
Why you make me sound like a booster, like a second story man?
Brother Love happened to
Brother
be there.
Brother Love could only be the other person.
He was
right?
waiting by the limo for me.
Sure.
And he was talking to them. He was giving them love.
Yeah.
But when I handed him
giving
$50.
Giving them the business. Give me a break, Brent. I've had
when I handed him $50, they handed it back. And I shoved it in their pocket. Whoa, what have you got there?
This snake.
No, no.
Right here.
No, no. Stop that now.
It's going to be around your neck before this program is over. I can
it's
guarantee
Christmas.
You that.
It's Christmas.
Christmas indeed.
No, get that thing out of here.
Plenty more
you?
Excitement still to come here. Anything's liable to happen.
Get
we'll
this
be right
thing
back.
Out of here now. It's Christmas.
Girls are the Bushwhackers. They're from New Zealand, but they get to spend Christmas with us. All right.
Yay.
With me at this time, boys and girls, are the Bushwhackers. They're from New Zealand, but they get to spend Christmas with us here on the World Wrestling Federation.
Whoa.
Butch, I'll get to you in a minute, but little Lukey, you probably want your two front teeth for Christmas.
No, Zendermate, no! I want the Brainbusters, don't we, guys?
The Brainbusters?
I want the Pals of Pain!
The Bolsheviks?
Yeah.
Well, boys, I don't know if I can deliver the Bolsheviks for you, but I'll keep you in mind for Christmas gift-giving.
You know, Santa, one good thing about being in America is not only the people so great, we get to meet celebrities like you, Santa.
That's
that
right, Santa.
So excited.
Boys, take
Santa,
it easy.
Santa.
Take it easy. I've had an accident or two on my knee. I don't want another one.
This is America, cuz. You know, Santa, when we knew we were coming to see you, we thought that you would like something from us. So we bought you a little present.
Give it to him, Cuss. Give it to him.
Well, that's very kind. This must come all the way from New Zealand.
Here we are, Santa. Would you like me to open it, mate?
Boy, I can smell it already. Ooh.
Have a look at this, Santa. You're going to love this, Santa. Look at this, mate. Sardines!
Look, Kurt!
Oh, yay!
Kurt!
Oh!
We can smell those pretty good.
Yes.
I thank you, boys.
It's Mean Gene!
Bushwhackers!
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
To one and to all.
I'm not going to sit out here as long as that bag's there.
Wonder
I'm
how they
sit
spend
here.
Their Christmases in New Zealand. I wonder how the Bushwhackers celebrate the holiday season. Don't even talk to me. I don't even want to talk to you. No, don't stick that hand out there, that hand that's got glue on the fingers. Give me a break, will you please? You've humiliated me. You insulted me. You insulted all the people here on the USA Network on Primetime Wrestling.
Not all of them. I missed one.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure you did. I'm sure you missed one.
But you can't insult him. He's in charge of
lighting. Interesting match coming up right now. Bad News Brown.
His opponent this evening making his way to the ring from Harlem, New York at 271 pounds, Bad News Brown.
You get a good look there at Jim Powers, and an outstanding wrestler he is. And that's got to be one of the meanest men in the business today. Bad News Brown out of Harlem, and he doesn't mind going walking in Central Park or Bedford-Stuyvesant all by his lonesome. And he is walking now to the ring here at the Los Angeles Sports Arena to take on Jimmy Powers. This should be a good one, Superstar.
Oh, no question about it, but I'll tell you what. Powers better get his act together and get together fast, man, because Bad News Brown is just all of the above that you mentioned, brother. He can walk in the park alone. He'll be a mugger. He can mug if he wants you to, brother, and right now he's just trying to make a tip.
Hey! It's like Powers had eyes in the back of his hand, and he saw Bad News Brown coming and took the play away, and now he throws off that warm-up jacket, and Jimmy Powers is ready to roll. And there goes Bad News Brown.
Yeah, he's going to turn around and come back. This kid Powers took him by surprise.
Did he ever?
And I'm surprised because, as we well know, Rod, you and I followed this kid in several of his matches. He's a slow starter. And never did he start fast this time, though, man, because I believe he knew that Bad News Brown was coming in here to take him out and take him out fast. So this kid Powers had to go ahead and make his move early, Rod.
It's like, fool me once, shame on you. Powers wasn't about to be fooled by the likes of Bad News Brown. And there he goes. Oh! Into the solar plexus. Small package here on Brown. And referee Jesse Hernandez gets to a two count. And wow, Powers is not starting slow in this one at all. And there again goes Brown.
Bad News Brown, man, he's being out-wrestled, out-fought, out-sight.
Outclassed.
Outclassed, absolutely. Jim Powers is on top of this game tonight. The best form we have seen him in, Rod. No question about it. The Bad News Bear better come back in here and figure some way out to stop this guy because he's needing an all-out assault, an all-out attack on the Bad News Bear.
And the capacity crowd here at the Los Angeles Sports Arena gets at him as he comes back in, and he makes some threatening gestures to those in the crowd as he makes his way back to the ring. And right now the referee is counting on him, and he better get back in here and beat that 10 count, which he does, or this one could have been over very, very quickly without Brown having an offensive move at all. Look at this. Look at this. Oh, cross my heart. Yeah, you better believe.
Hey, Powers falls for this.
And he hasn't done his homework. Hey, look at this. Look at here. Powers is indeed ready for Bad News Brown. Indeed. Jim Powers out of New York.
Oh, what a shot that was. Both feet on it in the air. Got him flush of the jaw. Now we're going to see the tide turn, my man, right now.
Now we will see how Mr. Bad News Brown takes charge.
Well, he weathered the storm. There's no question about that. Weathered it in fine style. I mean, Powers threw everything he had in his arsenal at him. Now Bad News Brown has turned the tables just like that.
Twice with judo shots to the throat. One blast to the back of the head.
Now we're going to find out how exactly what Powers is made out of, because Bad News Brown is going to be relentless. He will not let up.
Have you ever seen anyone, Superstar Billy Graham, survive the Ghetto Blaster?
No, I've never seen anyone. I don't think you have. Anybody commentating staff, Gorilla Monsoon, Jesse, Lord Alfred Hayes, none of us have seen the Ghetto Blaster. Anybody withstand that and continue. When he connects, brother, it's over. Right now, Powers better be thinking of a game plan.
Powers may have had his moment of glory here at the outset. And then it was the knees that caught him as he had whipped Brown into the corner and was coming after him. There's a flying crossbody, hooked leg. Oh, close but no cigar.
Yeah, you can't get any closer than that. That was about a 2.5 count. Caught Bad News Brown off guard with that flying tackle, Rod. The Bad News, as I said earlier, is going to be relentless. He's going to take every shot he can on this guy. Kicking the ribs, kicking the latissimus dorsi.
And that.
And I guarantee you'll go out after him. There he goes.
Bad News Brown.
Could do some damage out here.
Oh. On to the concrete. That mat is only about a half inch to an inch thick, and it really doesn't take much off a body slam. You could just as well be slammed on the concrete.
I agree. A half-inch mat with 3 feet of concrete beneath it.
Oh.
I'm telling you what, man. Powers is in big-time trouble right now. The back could be out. The hip could be out. The traps could be out. The shoulder. Anything on that move right there to slam on the floor. I think he's going to beat him now and humiliate him and just toy with the man at this point. I don't give Powers any chance, very slim chance of recovering from that slam on the floor. If he comes back from that, Rod, he's a better man than I thought he was.
Jimmy Powers in tremendous, tremendous condition. Look at that. He might have him. Got two.
He caught him with a finesse move, Rod, not a power move. That's the only reason that almost worked. It was a finesse move. His power strength is ebbing right now. He's taking a lot of punishment, Rod.
And there he just took some more from the boot of Bad News Brown. And they put a lot more, or there is a lot more, on a shot with somebody's foot than with a right hand like you just saw. Not that there isn't a lot of power and devastation behind right hands, but there's a lot more strength in a person's leg than in his arm. Bad News
reversal by Powers. Powers with a monkey flip.
Oh, the back gave out. The back that he got slammed on the floor. It gave out on that monkey flip, Rod. That's why Bad News Brown didn't go about 5 feet further when he got that, when he was on the receiving end of that monkey flip, because Powers' back gave out on him.
And Powers was unable to follow up. Now he goes to work with right hands and a headbutt and a whip.
Right now, Powers is only half the man that he was when he came into the ring.
Telegraphed that one.
Yes, and that slam on the floor took the game away from Jimmy Powers, I'm afraid.
Oh, a hard shot with a forearm to the jaw of Jimmy Powers. This one looks like it's almost ready to go into the double, you call him, for Bad News Brown. He really has Powers rocking and reeling. But Powers finding strength to fire and fight back. Brown gets out of the way, and you saw what happened to Jimmy Powers. He caught that top turnbuckle flush.
Bad News Brown, letting everybody know he's got some brains in that thick skull. He can think, and no question about it, man. He can think. He's setting him up for the ghetto blaster. I can see it coming. This kid is really dazed. He's dizzy. He's hurt bad. He's working on the back of his head right now, Rod.
Continues to work.
You know what it's like to be in here with a real man now, right?
I don't know if you heard that or not, but Bad News Brown saying, you know what it's like to be in here with a real man, right? Wow, he jerks Powers all the way back to the center of the ring.
Powers is getting a lesson in how much he can endure right here, I tell you what.
Again, a fist to the throat by Bad News Brown, and then to the choke.
Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it.
Brown. He's trying to intimidate the referee, Rod, right now.
Don't worry about it.
That referee, Jesse Hernandez, here's a strong whip. Powers gets out of the way of that one. Brown may have injured that left shoulder.
Yeah, just 1 minute ago, Brown was pointing to his head, telling everybody how smart he was, but that was a stupid move. Never charge a man. Very rarely do you want to charge a man, because usually that's the end result. When you charge a man when he's going to turn bubble, he's going to move on you.
Both of these men have taken a lot of punishment here. Powers the greater amount of punishment of the two, but that last blast which Brown took, you saw what had happened to him. He was able to get to his, what happened to him, he was able to get to his feet a bit more before Powers, but now he is back to the attack again.
The only thing saving Powers, Rod, in my opinion, is the muscle density on his body. The kid is thickly muscled, no question about it. And that's preserving him at this time right now, or he would have been out of the picture a long time ago. That slam on the floor about 5 minutes ago would have taken the ordinary wrestler out of the picture. But the muscular density is saving this kid right now.
The look on his face seems to indicate that he's just about out of it. And it took all he could muster to get that kick away, but it had a telling effect on Bad News Brown. But you see Powers flat on his back, and he does not recover anywhere near as quickly as Bad News Brown does.
Because the back gave out again, Rod. I saw him favor the back on the way down after he made the kick. The back was wrenched, and he fell down favoring the back once more.
But now suddenly it is Powers with three boots. Uh-oh. Brown catches a hold of the rope, and Powers catches nothing but air.
I can smell it coming right now.
Yes, so can I. We're talking about the ghetto blaster. Wow!
That wasn't the ghetto blaster, that was a counter.
Not at all. Not at all. And Brown was way, way, way off target with that one. And Powers catches him coming in. And Powers again back to work to the midsection of Bad News Brown. Clothesline.
Where's Powers finding his inner strength? I don't know where he's finding it, man. It's all hard right now, Rod.
The crowd is doing their best to help him out. He caught him that time.
Go for the covers, hooked him.
Leg over that lower rope, and the referee stops the count.
A little too close to the apron. Bad News Brown used his head there, man. Grabbed that bottom rope with a foot.
Powers trying to suplex him. Up and over he goes. Oh, so close, but yet so far away.
I tell you what, that's going to be frustrating to just get Powers, man. You suplex a man, you cradle him, you hook him, and you don't pin him. What do you do now?
That's what happens, and there's the ghetto blaster.
It's a little bit low, but still caught him on the lower left.
It did. It caught him enough to put him out. And Powers still hasn't moved. That count could have gone to 10.
Ladies and gentlemen, your winner, Bad News Brown.
Bad News Brown with that ghetto blaster winning another one for him. And despite the great conditioning of Jimmy Powers, it put him away.
Here we go, Rod. Rod with a replay. Bad News Brown taking control. We got a leapfrog coming up. He goes for a back body drop. Turns around. Powers off balance. Doesn't know where he's at. And bingo! There's a ghetto blaster at the base of the neck, base of the skull. And nobody gets up from that.
Not hard to understand why Bad News is still undefeated here in the World Wrestling. Why don't you go follow him? I'm sure that he's going to go down and rip somebody off.
Okay, I've had enough of this.
Go down to the Salvation Army, get a free meal, take it out of somebody else's mouth that needs it.
Okay, here's $200.
For what?
Whatever you want. Why don't you go have your super salute there, Columbo of Philadelphia, go find out where the needy family is and give
them
$200.
We know who the family, they're being taken care of.
Well, here's $200, I'm sorry then.
A lousy $200 is going to...
It's another $5, get a six-pack for him. I don't know what they...
Take you off the hook for a lousy $200?
Here's a blank check. Fill that out then. Let me get off the hook. You don't understand. They're from Philadelphia.
The only way you could get off this hook, Brain, is if you personally go down to Philadelphia and apologize and present these Christmas things to this needy family.
I will do that. See, they're from Philadelphia. They don't, you know, you can't understand people in Philadelphia anyway. I thought they were foreigners. There was a misunderstanding. I will go to their door. I'll knock on and say, I'm Bobby the Brain. I'm sorry.
How do you prepare for a matchup with that guy?
You don't. You just make sure you're in great shape. At the Summit in Houston, at the Royal Rumble, the Million Dollar Man will be wishing that he had the ability to turn his head around completely 360 degrees, because he'll be looking for Herc.
You know, a lot of people think he's going to buy his way to get the last number.
Well, that's
never
an
know.
Interesting thing, Brian. It's the luck of the draw in this particular type event. And if the Million Dollar Man wants to spread some money around, I'm sure there are some guys involved.
Hey, I'm willing to negotiate. I mean, I got the Red Rooster. I got Haku.
Let's go to our feature.
I can shove a lot of guys up in that spot.
This contest is scheduled for one fall. Soon to make his way towards the ring area, making his winter residence in Antilles in the Netherlands, weighing 246 pounds, here comes the Million Dollar Man, Ted DiBiase.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to Cox Coliseum here in Hamilton, Ontario. Boulevard Soon, along with Sean Rooney, as we take a look at the Million Dollar Man. He needs a little assistance getting down there, Sean.
Yes, indeed he does. And, you know, I'm wondering, you know, he has four residences.
Where's the stooge?
Yeah, where's the bodyguard Virgil?
What do you think his weekend off?
Yes, what do you think it costs to have four residences?
His opponent hails from Union City, Tennessee. Weighing 220 pounds. Here comes the Birdman, Coco Beware.
You can hear this crowd light up on the entrance of the Birdman, Coco Beware.
Where is he? I can't see him yet. They're on their feet here, though, it pops. There he is. Got Frankie with him.
He got new music these days?
Certainly doesn't sound like Paul Driver, does it?
No. Perhaps he's trying something new.
Definitely not Paul Driver. Frankie, though.
And he's still got the same dance.
The Bird almost took the bump there going through the ropes. SRO signs went out early here at Cops Coliseum. World Wrestling Federation, the hottest ticket in town. And this is one of the reasons why, this particular matchup.
Now this is going to be a good one. The Million Dollar Man, Ted DiBiase. We all know what he's like in the ring. The Birdman, Coco, Beware. It is high-flying moves, and right there, the Million Dollar Man, not wasting any time.
I think he needed that little bit of an edge, Sean. Sort of caught him off guard.
Back
Things like that
turned.
Are not supposed to happen to you when you're a pro, like Coco is. Nice drop kick, though, right in the kisser, and another one under the chin. DiBiase might have got more than he bargained for. There he goes.
Boy, what a rapid-fire series of moves by the Birdman right there. And the Million Dollar Man is upset.
He's looking for Virgil right now. Very unusual to see him enter anywhere without
his stooge. That's taking part of his arsenal away without the bodyguard Virgil.
And the money. He carries all the money. DiBiase might have tried to buy this match.
Think he's wearing a money belt today?
I doubt it.
Must be somewhere. You know, he wouldn't trust anybody back there in the locker room area with
definitely
it.
Definitely not. You don't want to give anybody any money back there. Be the last you ever saw of it.
A little
very
extra
important
advance.
Matchup. Oh, look at that. Sucker move. Went in for a nice referee's position tie-up.
Coco looks a little upset looking on there, Gorilla.
Look at. He didn't do his work. He didn't do his homework. You don't want to use those kind of moves on Coco. That's his strong point, that hard head.
All right, it's a Million Dollar Man who meets the turnbuckle.
Oh, right underneath the heart with that blow. Another standing drop kick. Coco does that as well as anybody.
He was trying to get out of the ring there, and he came up a little short.
Sure did. He was looking for lower ground. Coco's sporting a new... Oh, look at that leverage move.
I don't even think he even touched the rope.
That's where DiBiase is so dangerous. Inside that squared circle, aren't too many guys around, Sean Mooney, that know as much as this man does.
And what
inside.
About outside the squared circle?
Well, he knows
right,
enough
right
to get
the
back
bird
in.
Man. Oh. Got him right on the bridge of the nose
just
there on the
made
railing.
The count there, rolling in and then rolling right back out again. Otherwise, they both would have been counted out. And everybody goes home with a short end of the purse money. Not a good idea. Especially when you have the kind of overhead this guy has.
Yes, yes indeed. So many other outside interests as well.
I'm sure that the interest he makes on the about to go back to ringside in this most interesting matchup, our feature here this week on Primetime Wrestling. Understand the crew's got something for you.
What?
Well, look, it tell me it was snowing pretty hard. Oh, look at that. Put him right down here. Mr. Snowman.
It's snowing outside.
Yeah, it's really coming down out there. This guy's a beauty. I love it. Look at it. Didn't have any charcoal again.
Why don't I get the snowman?
Well,
why
this
don't
is
I get
for
any
you.
Snow?
This is for you, and you're
going
to get it.
Why do you get it?
Eventually, you'll get it, Brain. Believe me. Let's go back to ringside right now as the Million Dollar Man tries to figure out the moves of Coco and Frankie.
Something for you, too.
Yes, yes, indeed. But really, you have to wonder now how much of his income you think is based on his wrestling. I mean, he has so many other outside interests as well.
I'm sure that the interest he makes on the literally millions of dollars that he has far surpasses any income he could derive inside the squared circle.
So why does he do it?
Love. What else? Why else would you do it? If you don't love this sport of professional wrestling, you can't survive in it. It's too demanding.
Yes.
You have to love it. If you don't, forget about it. You're not going to last a week. You get your clock cleaned in a hurry.
You think he loves to dish out punishment to his
absolutely.
Opponents?
Humiliate people. A lot of guys get off on that.
Yes. And the Million Dollar Man certainly not short on ego.
Oh, no, definitely not. It's one of his fortes. He's having fun. This is his relaxation.
Some hobby.
However, he would love to have that WWF belt around his waist. I understand he made a comment that in 1989 he would, in fact, be wearing a championship belt.
Oh, really?
Yes, he did.
I hadn't heard that.
Yes.
At least says he always gets what he wants, one way or another.
Well,
he's got some awful tough competition out there. But the Macho Man Randy Savage, what about the Ultimate Warrior, the Intercontinental Champion?
What a handful that guy is. And then most of the time, he doesn't have both oars in the water.
Yeah. How do you prepare for a matchup with that guy?
You don't. You just make sure you're in great shape. Oh, a little bit late on that, sort of telegraphed that move and paid for it. Right into Schnozzola.
And you can see right there, that close-up, the effect that that knee had on Ted DiBiase.
You know, when you step in there with a guy like the Ultimate Warrior, you're in hopes of two things. One, that it doesn't terminate your career, and two, that he doesn't terminate you.
Yes.
He is the most unpredictable individual I've ever seen inside the squared circle, maybe with the exception of George the Animal Steel. Suplex well executed by the Million Dollar Man.
This is with the elbow, and again, Coco looks like he's ready to fly.
Well, Coco better get up for this match, or the lights will go out in a hurry. Cornered him now. Look out, unloading lefts and rights. Look at that uppercut. Coco's got to let loose with everything but the kitchen sink if he wants to get in the win column in this one.
Well, he seems to be doing that right now. We know if he gets caught in that million-dollar dream, he's in big trouble.
Oh, he got caught trying to go over the top. DiBiase quite a bit taller than he is, and he just got caught. London Bridge was falling down, and it was Coco Beware who was doing the downer.
He didn't even have a chance to get his hands out in front of him there. Landed face first on the canvas.
That could be the beginning of the end right there. Million Dollar Man now methodically going to work. Where's he going? Very high risk area for him. Oh, he wasted too much time up there. Took a look around. Gave Coco a chance to get it together.
Well, you'd think that the Million Dollar Man would have been more aware of that. After earlier in the match, we saw a miss with two elbows in succession right there off the ropes. Did it again.
Oh, put his head down, small package. Could be all over. He got him. Very clever maneuver on the part of the Million Dollar Man as he rolls out of there. Very lucky individual.
Here is your winner, the Million Dollar Man, Ted DiBiase.
He did what? How many?
He's.
They're saying that all the boxes you gave out were empty. Nothing in them. Just wrapped up.
What you don't understand is I gave six
empty boxes you gave out.
That's right, in case they should get a gift, they have something to put in them. Pretty nice of me. It's all they're worth anyway. What if they get a pair of underwear from their aunt? They got a box to put it in. Get some socks from Ann Hilden, Connecticut. Boom, they got a box.
Wouldn't you think those things would come in boxes?
I don't know. But I have something for you. Who cares about them? I mean,
what is this?
Merry Christmas.
The bill for the Last Supper?
Nope.
Well, what is it?
Read it.
Looks like a gift certificate. All expense paid night out on the town for the Gorilla and the Rosati sisters. What is this? Some kind of a joke? Or... Huh? All you can eat. What? This is some kind of a rib, right?
No.
No?
You're going to be at the front table at the Suet Inn.
Let's take a look at where the WWF is headed. I can't believe it.
It's the World Wrestling Federation on tour, coming to these great areas and facilities with action. Sunday, January 1st, Bristol, Tennessee, Viking Hall. Hacksaw Jim Duggan among those on the card in Bristol. Saturday, December 31st, Muskegon, Michigan, Walker Arena. In Muskegon that night, among others, you will see Akeem. Saturday, December 31st, Indianapolis, Indiana, Market Square Arena. The Mighty Hercules in action in Indianapolis. Saturday, December 31st, Hartford, Connecticut, the Hartford Civic Center. Demolition, tag team action in Hartford. Saturday, December 31st, Springfield, Illinois, Prairie Capital Convention Center. Hulk Hogan will be on the card in Springfield. Saturday, December 31st, Lansing, Michigan, Lansing Arena. The Honky Tonk Man among those on the card in Lansing. It's the World Wrestling Federation. Be a part of it when it comes to your area.
Come on in. Feel the fluffiest softness ever.
Come on in. Fluffy, soft,
fluffy.
Soft, softest feeling.
Deep fryers. Jump into the ring.
And with the VCR WrestleMania game, you can win.
Look for VCR WrestleMania and VCR quarterback game from Acclaim.
Well, folks, that's it for this special Christmas edition of Primetime Wrestling. Next week, we'll be back here It'll be 1989, and it will be a happening. It'll be a special New Year's event here on Primetime Wrestling. Don't forget, it's not too early, and it's not too late, so get on the horn and order. Be a part of the Royal Rumble going down January 15th at the Summit in Houston. Brain, I understand that the crew has some additional gifts for you.
As in cash?
Yes, and here they come.
Wait a minute. Wait a minute now. Stop that.
Oh, I love it. Stop. Let them have it, guys.
Now, wait a minute. I can explain everything. There's no reason to do this now.
Yeah? Oh!
Ow!
Get him!
Oh!
Get him! Hold your fire, guys. He's hiding around some of that expensive equipment back there. He's no dummy. Well, that's a wrap from this end for this special Christmas primetime edition. Next week will be 1989, and it will be a whole new year for Primetime Wrestling. I want each and every one of you to be out there and be here for it. So please, don't drink and drive. So until then, Gorilla Monsoon for the Thief in the Night, who's probably halfway down the highway by now. So long, everyone.
Four top teams take the court on USA's college basketball. Wednesday at 9, it's Arkansas and Missouri. And Thursday at 9, it's Memphis State against Tennessee. Now stay tuned as Crockett becomes a godfather that even Marlon Brando would be proud of. No horseheads in bed, please. On Miami Vice, next on USA.